हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आई वेलकम यू ऑल। इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी स्टार्टेड पोएट्री सेक्शन एंड द पोयम दैट वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न इज माय मिस्ट्रेस आईज आर नथिंग लाइक द सन। The title itself that you are going to learn is very interesting because it is something very unconventional that the poet is actually talking about. As I told you yesterday, that the sonneteers of the Shakespearean time were very much fond of writing poetry, more particularly in the praise of their beloved. And the present poem that we are going to learn, which is titled as My Mistress' Eyes Are Nothing Like the Sun, is something unconventional. But before I proceed with the poem, first of all, I would like to let you know the structure of this poem in particular. In my previous lecture, I told you all that Shakespeare did not follow the custom of writing sonnet as it was introduced by Petrarch. Petrarchan sonnets are generally divided into two stanzas, that is octave and sustain. Octave is a stanza of 8 lines and sustain is a stanza of 6 lines. So 8 plus 6 is equal to 14 lines poem is called a sonnet. Here, when we study Shakespearean sonnets, which are also known as English sonnets, in the structural point of view, the number of lines are similar. That is, Shakespeare also adhered to the regulation of having 14 lines in his sonnet. But there is a minor deviation that he made in the structure of the poem. Shakespearean stanzas are not simply divided into octave and sustain. On the other hand, William Shakespeare has made a division of the poem into 4 sections. You have 3 quatrains plus a couplet. A quatrain means a stanza of 4 lines and a couplet means a stanza of 2 lines. So 4 threes are 12 plus 2. In all total you have 14 lines in the Shakespearean sonnets. So the present sonnet that we are going to learn, titled as My Mistress' Eyes Are Nothing Like the Sun, is known for its simplicity and frankness of expressions. This sonnet also gives us a message in a very simple way, that is all about the beauty of his beloved cannot be compared to the beautiful objects and phenomenon of the nature. And that's why the title itself is very apt and suggestive. Right in the very first line, the poet says, My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun. First of all, I would like to remind you all that this poem, that is, My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun, is a kind of appreciation that of the beloved of the poet. But the line 1 itself is very apt and suggestive and striking to our minds also. Generally, whenever a person or a lover admires the beauty of his beloved, he is either being exaggerative or hyperbolic, using literary words which are the kind of exaggerations of the beauty of the woman. But in this respect, you will realize that right in line 1, that is, "My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun," it will let you know that the poet is very bluntly saying that the beauty of the eyes of my beloved cannot be compared with the brightness of the sun at all. Obliquely, it also indicates that her eyes are not bright, just like the sun. On the other hand, they are probably dull and dim. So here, the question arises in the mind of the reader, like you or me, that whether the poet is appreciating the beauty of his beloved, or he is diminishing or negatively talking about the beauty of his beloved. Whether his beloved was really beautiful or not, that is also another question. Because in the introduction yesterday, I told you that some of the poems out of 154 are addressed to a dark lady. So when the poet himself is calling his beloved as a dark lady, so here again the different issues will be raised, right? So let us look at this poem in the critical point of view, so that you will be able to enjoy it and learn so many things from this particular poem as such. So the poem goes like this. See here now. I am going to start the first stanza. I hope all of you have your textbooks with you. Without the textbook, probably you will not be able to learn. So my humble request to all of you that you should have your own textbook right in front of you, so that you will be able to enjoy and learn the poem. Let us look at this first stanza. I am going to read out the quatrain 1. "My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun. Coral is far more red than her lips red. If snow be white, why then her breasts are dun? If hairs be wires, black wires grow on her head." Probably all of you might have understood one thing here, that the poet has been so unconventional while appreciating the beauty of his own beloved. In the very first line, that is, "My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun," the poet says that his beloved's eyes are not at all bright like the sun. It means they are dull and dim. Number 2, from here onwards, the speaker presents a description of the beloved in exactly opposite manner. Right. Earlier, you might have read in the world of literature, whosoever has written about the beauty of his beloved, probably you might have studied that, you might have seen that, you might have observed that the poets are exaggerative as far as the admiration of the beauty of the beloved is concerned. But Shakespeare is not doing so. Shakespeare has adopted the different style of writing here. Instead of admiring the real beauty or making it little bit exaggerative, the poet has made humor out of it. See the first line itself. "My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun." Here, the poet has used a simile. Simile is a poetic device in which the similarity or a kind of resemblance is shown. and it is indicated with the word like, like, or as, as. So in this particular expression, the poet is trying to present a similarity between two things. One, the eyes of the mistress, and second, the sun. Okay, comparison is made, no doubt. But there is one negative word in between, that is nothing. When the poet says, my mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun, it means he is trying to compare two different things. One, the eyes of the mistress. Number two, the sun. As we know, throughout the world, the kind of brightness that we experience, that of the sun, is known to everybody. But here the poet says, my mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun. It means the brightness of the sun cannot be compared with the eyes of my beloved. It also means that, as we could see the brightness of the sun everywhere, the eyes of my beloved are so dull and dim. Now the question arises in the mind of the reader like you or me, whether the poet is appreciating the beauty of his beloved, or on the contrary, he is talking about something negative about her. So now, I'm going to put this question in front of you also, and keep thinking throughout the poem when I will talk about this particular aspect. Now you see the second line. Coral is far red than her lips red. Okay, coral, it is one of the precious stones. I think in Marathi you call it pavla. If you go to the jeweler shop, you will find one small size precious stone called coral, and it is red in color, right? So coral is far more red. The fundamental principle of coral is to give you a kind of shining red color, right? Here the poet says, coral is far more red than her lips red. So now there is a comparison between two things again. One, the redness of the coral, which is a precious stone available with the jewelers. Second, the color of the lips of his beloved, right? The lips should be either pink or red, and if at all they are polished, they should be as expected. So the poet is trying to make a comparison here and trying to give us another negative aspect of the beauty of his beloved. Coral is far more red than her lips red. So when you make the comparison between the two things, the redness of the lips of his beloved and the redness of the precious stone that is coral, so according to the poet, coral is much better. The color of the coral is much better than the color of her lips. So you see here, many doubts will again be raised in your mind. Whether the poet is appreciating the beauty of his beloved, or he is talking something quite negative about her. See now, I will just explain once again. The poet says that the precious gem, that is red gem, which is called a coral, is far redder than her lips. This is the pure comparison made by the poet. Actually, the poet means to say, her beloved's lips are pale and dull, and they are not at all red. So she has lost the glory of the, you know, reddishness or the pink color of her lips. They are dull, pale, blackish kind of lips. So again, as I have been talking right from the beginning, whether the poet is appreciating the beauty of the beloved or he is talking negatively about her beauty, that you need to judge properly. Then you have the third line. If snow be white, why then her breasts are done. Here he is talking and he is comparing the color of his beloved, that with the whiteness of the snow. As you know that white color is the symbol of purity, right? And complete whiteness of the snow is also considered to be the color for purity, at least in our context. So he is trying to compare the beauty of his beloved with the whiteness of the snow. The poet says, the breasts and the skin of the beloved were usually described by the poets to be whiter than the snow. If you see, the other poets or the other contemporary sonneteers of William Shakespeare, you will realize that most of the sonneteers of his time, they always compared the whiteness or the beauty of their beloved with the whiteness of the snow, and they always claimed that their beloved is more white than the whiteness of the snow. But William Shakespeare is not doing that. On the contrary, William Shakespeare is trying to tell that his beloved is not really white. And already I told you, right in the introduction, that some of the sonnets which are addressed by William Shakespeare in the sequence of sonnets, that is 154 sonnets, he has addressed a few sonnets to a dark lady. And once you say that the poems are addressed to the dark lady, dark means, it means she is not fair as expected. She is not white as expected. If you see an European person and you try to compare with an African person, probably you will make the contradiction very quickly. Because black and white, if at all both are brought together, you can compare and contrast. So the poet has already said in the, you know, some of the poems of his sequence that he is addressing his sonnets to a dark lady. And when the lady herself is dark, so there is no question that she will have a very fair white color of her skin. So this line is giving you an apt description of her beauty. But mind it well, black is also beautiful. Generally, we people have our own assumption that white is beautiful or fair is beautiful. By the means of this poem, William Shakespeare is trying to convey us that dark or black is also equally beautiful. So let us look at this. If snow be white, why then her breasts are done? If hairs be wires, black wires grow on her head. My goodness. See the kind of expression made here. This is the very unconventional approach which is adopted by the poet. Here, as I said in the previous line also, the poet is trying to present a kind of contrast by saying the darkness of the color of her skin, because he has already addressed his poems to a dark lady. Dark in the sense a brownish color. Dun, D-U-N, when you use the word dun, dun means brownish color. You know, if at all you go to the United States of America, what do the Americans call us? We, the Indian people, they call us brown. We are neither black nor white. It means we are not completely dark or black like the Negroes of Africa. And we are not very white or fair like the Europeans. So they call us brown. And here, the poet has said, and he is trying to present a contrast also. What kind of contrast? The contrast by saying that her breasts are of dull brownish color. It means her skin, is colored brown. It is not white as expected. And one more fact we need to understand. The speaker has already cleared it, that the fact that his mistress is a dark colored lady. She is not a white woman. So that is all clear over here. And when you look at a dark colored lady or a Negro or a black lady, you will find that the kind of hairstyle that the Africans maintain is something really different. And so the next line, the fourth line of this particular stanza, gives you that idea. When the poet says, if hairs be wires, if at all, hairs, okay, long hair, hairs be wires, then the poet says, black wires grow on her head. Have you ever seen any black lady? The kind of small size piglets, you know, or the locks that the women maintain is something really different that is found only in the African countries or the immigrated people from Africa to the US or European countries. So the poet has talked about it. The poet says, the hair was usually compared with the golden wires, mind it well. Right? And golden wires in the sense used in the jewelry or embroidery in order to enhance the beauty of your long hair. But here, the poet is presenting this in a very opposite way. To present the same opposite of this kind, the speaker says that his mistress' hair is like black wires. And this is the further shock that the readers get like us. And here, the first quatrain comes to an end. Probably some of you, those who have already studied some of the poems in appreciation of the beauty of a woman, they might have been shocked after listening to such kind of appreciation of the beauty. So these four lines, once again I read out. My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun. Coral is far more red than her lips red. If snow be white, why then her breasts are dun? If hairs be wires, black wires grow on her head. Here the poet says, if at all you want to claim that, if at all you want to say that the hairs are nothing but the wires, then what is actually growing on the head of my beloved? The black wires are growing. So once again I repeat, throughout the poem, you will realize that the poet has used the unconventional style of writing. This is not the conventional style of writing. So here I would like to put a pause. In my next class tomorrow, I'll teach you the second stanza or the second quatrain of this particular poem, My Mistress' Eyes Are Nothing Like the Sun, written by William Shakespeare. So, once again, I request you all, listen to the song that I suggested and read the poem that I taught you so far. Thank you very much. See you tomorrow.